Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, we are going to cover all of the attributes that exist up through C++ 23. But before we dig into that, I would like to remind you that I am teaching a C++ Best Practices class at NDC Tech Town in September of 2024. In Kongsberg, Norway. So if you have any interest at all in attending this workshop, please check this out and come to my best practices class. Okay, so we're going to start with the attribute no return. And this quite literally tells the compiler that this function is not going to return. Perhaps it is always going to throw an exception, or it's going to call terminate or exit, or in some way interrupt normal program flow. So if I've got a function that returns a value, the compiler is going to rightly tell me that this function does not return a value through all code paths. If I were to call this thing called func, then I'm no longer going to get that error from the compiler because it knows that func is a no return. Now, if I remove the no return attribute, I will go back to getting an error saying control flow reaches the end of this function. So that is the point, is to tell the compiler this function is never going to return, so you don't have to worry about what happens in the case where it does return. Now, the next attribute to cover in order that it was added to the language is carries dependency. And this is fascinating because it appears to be a very poorly understood attribute. And I can say I have never used this in my own code, not even in example code. CVP reference says that this indicates that dependency chain in a release consume standard memory order propagates in and out of the function, which allows the compiler to skip unnecessary memory fence instructions. It may appear in two situations. It may apply to the parameter declaration of a function or lambda expression, in which case it indicates that the initialization of the parameter carries dependency and the L value to R value conversion of that object. Or it may apply to the function declaration as a whole, in which case it indicates that the return value carries dependency to the evaluation of the function call expression. Now, just to drive home the point that this seems to be very poorly understood, is the CVP reference example is copied from Stack Overflow. Go and do your own homework if this looks interesting to you, but we can see in this particular example that what we are doing is loading a pointer from an atomic that has a particular memory order assigned to it, and then when we pass it to this print function, we are indicating that this pointer carries a dependency. What exactly that means and how it affects the generation of code, I know not. But an interesting link here at the bottom is kill dependency, where you can take something that carried the dependency and then break the dependency chain if you wanted to. And also another interesting note is that it says this attribute must appear on the first declaration of a function or one of its parameters in any translation unit. If it is not used on the first declaration of a function or one of its parameters in another translation unit, the program is ill-formed, no diagnostic required. I was just discussing with a friend that this is equivalent to saying that the program has undefined behavior. An ill-formed program does not have any requirements set on it, and no diagnostic required means that the compiler doesn't have to tell us that we did this wrong. So, well, if you're going to use carries dependency, make sure you know what you're doing. Okay, the next one to call is pretty straightforward, and it is deprecated. And if I try to call this function, I'm going to get a warning from the compiler. Warning, I called a deprecated function, and I have warnings as errors enabled, so this becomes a hard compile failure. Now, this is one of the first attribute to actually allow you to have a description here, where we might be able to say something like this. We don't want to break ABI compatibility, but we want to still give you an alternative. If you call this function, you're somehow going to invoke undefined behavior. Please call the updated function instead. We see this kind of thing fairly often in old C APIs that were very difficult to use correctly and newer, safer checked ones. So you could mark the old one as deprecated and point the user to the new thing. Now, the next added in C++ 17 is fall through. And this I find to be one of the more interesting ones. Okay, let's take this very ill-conceived process function here. If I were to do something like this, then I am pretty rightly going to get an error from the compiler saying this statement may fall through. And the idea being that if case 0 is executed, I update the local variable and then I continue on to case 1. This is the source of many bugs in switch statements. Now, if I don't have anything that I do in the case of case 0, then this compiles like it should. We're going to skip ahead to the next attribute. So I don't get a warning here, but I do get a warning here. Now, say I did actually want to do something like this. That is what the fall through attribute is for. I am able to tell the compiler, yes, I am intending to fall from case 0 through to case 1 and do some steps along the way. So that's fall through. That was added in C++ 17. Well, while we're at it, let's go ahead and discuss no discard, which was also added in C++ 17. And this is where we indicate that calling this function and ignoring its return value is a bug. So if I call this with the value 10 and I do nothing with it, then I get ignoring return value of this function. And that is because I have marked the function as no discard. Now note that I can also mark types as no discard. So if I make this error thingy no discard, then anytime that I drop a value of it on the floor, then I'm going to get a warning from the compiler. And as we just saw a moment ago, if I have unused variables turned on, then I can't get around this by just having a capture of this thing with a name. I'm getting this set but not used, which is where maybe unused comes into play. Now, generally speaking, I feel like maybe unused is a little bit of a code smell, but it can definitely be useful in the case where you have blocks of code that are conditionally compiled, and in some cases you do use a parameter, in other cases you don't use a parameter. So let's do a quick synopsis. Okay, so this brings us to C++ 20s, likely and unlikely. And I have done individual episodes about most of these things, just so you know. So let's take this random function called getValue. And we have a comparison against 43, that's the if greater than 42, then return 10, and it does a conditional move, so this doesn't have any actual branching in it. But the point of likely and unlikely is for me to say, you know what, it's actually unlikely that the input is greater than 42. I want you to compile to optimize for the else case. And I don't expect that this actually changed. No, it actually did change the generated code. So this is a compare to 42, move to 10, conditional move, okay. That's 4 instructions. Oh, now it's producing the exact same code. Well, interesting. But the point is, likely and unlikely, let us specify which branch we think is likely or unlikely to occur in our code, so that gives a hint to the compiler as to which one it should optimize for. Okay, now the next one is no unique address. And I'm going to preface this section by saying that Visual Studio still does not properly actually honor no unique address because it broke some stuff that they cared about, apparently. But the idea is that each object in C++ must have a unique address. So we can't really create an object of zero size. So if I return a size of the struct s, I'm going to get 1. because each object has to have its own unique address. So if I add an object of type empty 1, then I'm still going to get a size of 1 for the struct s because it is containing exactly one object of the size 1 itself. And if I add another object of a different type here of empty 2, then now I'm getting 2 for the size of the struct because each of these things must have their own unique address. No unique address is designed for optimizing this kind of scenario where we want to kind of compress or collapse things that we know are empty inside of our struct. And now I have two objects with the same address, which is slightly disconcerting. There, as we can see, these two different objects have the same address. But if I were to get rid of this no unique address attribute on them, then I should see different addresses. Now, interestingly, I do actually expect the object S itself to have the same address as its first member, and that is well-defined behavior and what we've always expected for this particular case, that an address of an object is the same as the address of the first element in that object. Yes, there we go. Okay, so no unique address, C++ 20. And that brings us to our final one, which is assume. And I did cover this in a previous episode in more detail than I'm going to get into today, but we can just tell the compiler, well, here, let's go ahead and make another demonstration of it. This is a very meaningless example, just so you know. But the point is to illustrate what assume can do. So this function doesn't have a proper return path here. We have control reaches into the non-void function. Now, in this case, I've told it I can assume that I is less than or equal to 42. The analysis the compiler is doing is still telling me that I have control flow that doesn't reach through this function. So let's go ahead and return like an error of -1 if we shall. So looking at the generated code here, it either returns 10 or it returns the value that was passed in. If I get rid of the assume, then it's going to actually put in some branching and it's going to have the code that might return -1 in this particular case. Here we can see here code that might return -1. Okay, so that's the idea of assume. You can tell the compiler to make certain assumptions about the values during execution. It is definitely a possible gateway to undefined behavior as well, so I'd be careful using it. But that wraps up all of the currently approved attributes from C++ 11 to C++ 23. So I hope you enjoyed this episode and be sure to subscribe.